It's time to let him go. Welcome to the Film Threat Podcast. I am Chris Gore, and I am pleased to talk to the director of Let Him Go, Thomas Bezucha. Thomas, is that, did I pronounce your name correctly?
You nailed it. Just like the bubble.
Okay, good. Yeah. First of all, I'm so excited to talk to you about this film because this is the reunion of two actors I have loved for years, Diane Lane, Kevin Costner. Yeah. And to see them reunited again, they worked so well in Man of Steel. This is like a Man of Steel reunion, in a sense.
Right.
Did that play into your casting when you brought them together? Because they, whatever you think about the movie Man of Steel, I happen to be in the camp of people who loved it. Certainly, there's no denying that the chemistry with Diane and Kevin Costner is just bar none. I could see more movies with them, but tell me what led to that casting decision.
Well, you know, I'm not the one who invented chocolate and peanut butter, but I am smart enough to recognize that they taste good together. I got lucky. I sort of won the lottery twice. Diane came on early. I had a lunch with her, and she had just a great, strong idea of what she wanted to do with the Margaret character. And then we went to Kevin. And as I said, I sort of hit the lottery twice.
Well, for sure. It's one of those things also, like I've loved Kevin Costner for years, and Dance of Wolves is still a personal favorite of mine. It's interesting when you see like an actor will put on their resume, can ride a horse. Kevin Costner can actually ride a horse. Tell me what it was like doing those scenes with him. And then additionally, there is some gunplay in this. And Costner, no surprises, is very convincing. What kind of physical performances? What is it like to work with Kevin on those?
He knows his way around. The horses and I was definitely new to that playground, and was grateful to have him as a partner. But it definitely was sort of, for me, I become a fan, and I also love Dances with Wolves. And when you're out there in the middle of Alberta, Canada, and Kevin's on a horse, you know, you're filming Kevin on a horse, how did it come to this? I'm not sure.
Well, I feel like we could maybe give us both some pointers on riding horses.
He's so modest though. He says, I don't ride well. He's like, I can make it look like I ride well. He's like, but the horse wranglers, he's like, they ride well.
Well, he's certainly a convincing actor in that regard for sure. Yeah. Tell me this, this movie, Let Him Go, is an adaptation of a novel.
Yeah.
What were the differences, with the novel and the adaptation? What were some of the challenges in putting that together?
Sure. The novel by Larry Watson, who I've been a fan of for a long time. It's pretty true to the novel. I changed the direction of the road trip. In the novel, they live in North Dakota and travel to Montana. I had them live in Montana and go to North Dakota just because I wanted to sort of start in this paradise of greenery and they go to hell, essentially. This, not that North Dakota's hell, but it don't compare to Montana. And then the time, the novel set in 1951, and I moved it to 1963. It made sense to me that these are sort of the last days of American innocence before Kennedy's assassination. And so that became a factor. But other than that, it's pretty true to the novel.
It also feels like, I would say, like a modern Western in a sense. Yeah. I mean, there's a sort of like where this remote location where a chunk of the film takes place, there's a lawlessness that, and mm-hmm. I would say in one, there's a dinner scene that's about a midwife film that is kind of frightening. Just because they're in the middle of nowhere, there's a palpable like tension in that scene. And dinner scenes are always, when I talk to directors, the dinner scenes are the scenes that they fear the most.
I love them. I've got one in the middle of the family stone. It's nearly as uncomfortable.
But this one, tell me about what, you know, setting that scene up and also any comparisons to a modern Western. I feel like the Western is just never going to go away. It's just going to evolve. I mean, what you did, Let Him Go. And then if you even look at the television, the Disney Plus series, The Mandalorian, I mean, that's a Western, right? Yeah.
Well, it's our Norse mythology. We're in for America. It's the realm of the gods, and it's the American fable is in the West. It's interesting. I think that dinner scene is, if you imagine it as a shootout, it's just they're warring factions in a closed space, and with Diane and Kevin and Leslie Manville, who plays Blanche, and Kevin and Diane are outgunned, and they need to figure out how to stage a retreat. I love that scene because I think it's the pivot point in the movie, and they start to realize what they're up against.
Well, it's interesting. I'm glad you brought up the actress who plays Blanche. We've talked about, you know, Kevin and Diane. They're such a great match, a great acting couple. I mean, their chemistry on screen is amazing. But the rest of the cast is
they're
incredible. How did you put together? How did you cast this this family? This
the wee boys.
It's pretty frightening.
They're something. Well, you start with getting a great casting director, and I had the best, A.V. Kaufman, who's just spectacular. But how did the wee boy thing? It was tricky. I think we built the Blackledge family first, and so it was Kevin and Diane, and Kaylee Carter, it plays their daughter-in-law. She was in early, and I think we were going for Blanche and Bill and Donnie Wee Boy all at the same time, and got Jeffrey Donovan for Bill and Will Britton for Donnie. And the Blanche character was weirdly the hardest. And Leslie, I think, may have been cast last. Not because I knew her from all these Mike Lee movies, but it was, there was an idea that had to be an American part, and I wasn't convinced of that. And I thought Leslie could, I knew she could do it. And I really wanted Blanche. I wanted the audience not to recognize her when Kevin and Diane meet her. And so that became part of part of the strategy for going for Leslie.
Is it fair? Tell me if I'm completely off base.
Okay.
Is it fair to compare this film or like aspects of it to The Searchers? Is that?
Well,
I mean,
no, I appreciate it. And you know, there's a shot in the movie that when they go to Peter Dragwolf's shack, mm-hmm. there's a shot through an open doorway of him leading a horse away that is sort of like the last shot in The Searchers. And we built the cabin. We built his little cabin so it would face that way so we could get that shot. So,
well, you know, certainly, but drawing inspiration, I mean, that's a good thing, right?
It's a great thing, right? No, steal from anywhere you can, for sure.
Well, Thomas, thank you for talking to us on the Film Threat Podcast. I want to thank our sponsor, Storyblocks. Go to storyblocks.com/filmthreat. Makes it possible for us to talk to filmmakers. I have to compliment you on your poster. That's 400 blows in the background. Like, oh my God.
You got
that's so cool. You got, yeah. You know, sometimes I talk to filmmakers, they have their laundry in the background. You've got an amazing poster. I should mention also that the movie is in theaters, and boy, if we could use a break and get to a movie theater to see a new film. Although where I'm at, mostly theaters aren't open, but drive-ins are open.
So do it safely. Do it safely.
Yeah. Well, drive-in is the I think that's the best way to go see a movie now. I've been to the drive-in every week.
Wow. Where?
In Pasadena, I'm close to like 3 drive-ins.
Oh, great.
Yeah. It's fantastic. Yeah.
Good.
Awesome. Thomas, thank you so much for talking to us on the Film Threat Podcast. Congratulations on the film.
Thanks. Take care.
You too.